I'm Dr. John Iskander. Welcome to CDC Beyond the Data. I'm here today with Captain Jordan Tappero, Director of CDC's Division of Global Health Protection. Welcome.
Thank you, John. I'm looking forward to the discussion.
First of all, Jordan, I'd like to thank you for the service that you've provided to the U.S. and to the world, both as part of the Ebola outbreak response and many other responses you've been involved with, including following the Haiti earthquake. Our session today was subtitled Lessons from Ebola. What are some of the lessons from Ebola for global health security going forward?
Well, thank you, John. You know, I think there's a couple ways to think about the lessons from this experience. And unfortunately, we're still trying to finish this Ebola epidemic in West Africa with, although down to a handful of cases, they still continue. I guess the first thing would be CDC has been responding to Ebola since it was first identified in 1976 for about almost four decades. Over those years, we've been involved in over 20 outbreaks. We've learned what we need to do to stop them. But in West Africa, it was unexpected. So the first thing to take away as a lesson is that an infectious disease can pop up anywhere at any time. I think East Africa, Central Africa, there'd been enough understanding that when Ebola happens, you can reach the public, hopefully limit the number of cases, and stop the outbreak within several weeks, if not months. But in West Africa, the understanding of Ebola was just not on anyone's radar screen. And so when it first struck, cases went undetected for quite some period of time. And so it started in the forest area of Guinea and spilled over into Liberia and Sierra Leone, up in the forested, very rural areas. And because of problems with poor healthcare service delivery and infection control practices in these rural areas, as well as porous borders with movement, and finally, not such a far distance from these forested rural areas to the capital cities, there was just so much transmission happening before there was a global response. So we need to be quick, and we also need to be aware that an infectious disease threat can occur anywhere at any time, even when it hasn't been there before.
So yes, very, very important lessons. Now, you highlighted today maybe an unnoticed or underappreciated success of the Ebola response, which was what happened in Nigeria. Can you tell us a little bit about that and what lessons we should learn there?
Sure. The public health system infrastructure in Guinea, Liberia, and Sierra Leone is fairly nascent. There is really poor surveillance or understanding of reportable diseases that public health systems should always be monitoring for. In Nigeria, there had been two elements that had really helped prepare it for the introduction of Ebola that happened last summer. The first was there had been wild-type polio virus that had reemerged in northern Nigeria. And because of that and the global effort to eradicate polio, there was an emergency operations center, or EOC, that had been stood up with a well-trained incident management system, or people who understand how to trace emergent public health problems and have direct access to the highest levels of leadership so that decisions can be made quickly and avoid a bureaucracy. In addition, that polio emergency operations center with its well-trained workforce was easily able to pivot and stand up an emergency operations center for the introduction of Ebola. In addition, CDC has been training shoe leather field epidemiologists in Nigeria for almost a decade. That program is known as the Field Epidemiology Training Program. And we had 13 trainees actively in the program and 14 graduates that immediately were able to be brought into that incident management system and directed to do contact tracing. And so the first case resulted in several more, in fact, a total of 19 over a span of a couple of weeks, or excuse me, months. But there were thousands of people on contact lists that had contact with individuals who were sick that were followed daily for a period of 3 weeks. And as individuals who were contacts became sick, they were quickly isolated. And that dramatically decreases the risk of transmission to others. So after 19 chains of transmission, the Ebola epidemic or outbreak in Nigeria, fortunately, was stopped. We have grave concerns in Nigeria because it is the most populous country in all of Africa, and it is also an international travel hub for much of the continent. So truly, that was one of the more frightening moments of the Ebola outbreak, was if Ebola had become community-wide transmission in Nigeria with cities of 20 million people, we might never have been able to stop this epidemic.
So two core elements of global health security and the global health security agenda, an EOC and the field epidemiology trainees, they had that in place and that was enough. But the vision for global health security is broader than that. What else is involved?
So it's essentially a prevent, detect, and respond model. The reason global health security agenda was put into action was because after the severe acute respiratory syndrome outbreak in Asia in 2003, which resulted in 37 countries over three continents being affected by SARS and over 800 deaths, or around 800 deaths, there was concern that we weren't ready for this kind of outbreak. So the World Health Organization revised its international health regulations in 2005. And they started a five-year clock in 2007 that all countries under the UN umbrella that committed to working towards compliance with the international health regulations would meet them. But by 2012, only 20% of countries were able to even self-report compliance with the international health regulations. And after a two-year extension in 2014, only an additional 10% were able to meet that self-report. So 70% of the world is not protected from these kind of introductions of a severe infectious disease pathogen. So the Global Health Security Agenda was brought in to help countries identify activities that they could do to strengthen their public health system so that it's resilient and it can respond to an infectious disease threat introduction. We all know that the Global Health Security Agenda is intended to help every country be as best prepared as possible, because the world is only as prepared as its weakest link in terms of its public health system infrastructure. So the model of Global Health Security Agenda is a prevent, detect, and respond model. There are four under the prevent piece, there are three under the respond piece, and there are also four under the detect piece. You had mentioned two of them, the Emergency Operations Center for managing a public health event that is of great concern, as well as a workforce that's trained to go out and do the shoe leather contact tracing around individuals that are cases, so that we can identify who is at risk and isolate them and provide them care if they do become ill. There are others that are addressing several different activities, and I probably won't go through all 11, but I'll say a few more. Every country needs to have a national reference laboratory capable of doing six core diagnostic tests, as well as having a specimen referral network that can reach at least 80% of its administrative districts or counties. If that is in place, then there should be a standard surveillance system that is constantly looking for confirmation of serious pathogens when there is an individual who becomes sick in a community somewhere with a syndrome or a complex set of signs and symptoms of illness that suggest a serious pathogen could be present. If that testing is happening routinely, then the public health workforce can go out and do the investigation and hopefully not only save lives immediately in that community, but stop ongoing transmission between family members and their community.
So for many of our audience who may work at health departments, this may sound like sort of public health 101. You need surveillance, you need some lab capacity, you need trained personnel, and you need structures and trained personnel to be able to respond in times of emergency. So where, both geographically and in terms of policy, where is the global health security agenda going in the next 5 years?
Yes, thank you. The Global Health Security Agenda was launched to actually help the international health regulations come into compliance globally. It was launched on February 13th of 2014. And while 28 nations joined the launch, there was also efforts to work with WHO and the animal health organizations, FAO and OIE, so that there would be transparent reporting globally. Then when Ebola happened just a few months later, the global community had to deal with the perfect, unfortunate, real-life example of why the global health security agenda is so critical. And because of that, the United States Congress in December, in the heat of a deeply concerning epidemic of Ebola in West Africa that was still unclear how far it could spread, in the heat of that moment, the Congress passed the president's emergency funding request. That emergency funding request was for about $6 billion. CDC received about $1.8 billion. Of that, a third of it went for domestic preparedness across the nation. Another third went to working with the three affected countries with Ebola, as well as their neighboring countries that were highly at risk for introduction and ongoing transmission. And lastly, global health security agenda, the 11 targets, we touched on four of them, the 11 targets that are intended to help build those resilient public health systems around the world. In early January, 17 countries were identified where the U.S. government would begin partnering to implement the global health security agenda activities. The U.S. pledged to work in 30 countries around the world, and also because of Ebola, that real-life example, many other countries have stepped forward with resources and technical assistance to join the agenda. We now had the second ministerial meeting around global health security agenda in Seoul, Korea, just a few weeks back in September. At that, 51 countries pledged activities and commitments to the global health security agenda, and the G7, which met in June in Germany, also pledged to provide resources and technical assistance to bring the total number of countries from 30 that the U.S. government has committed to work in, up to 60. So there are over 195 nations under the UN umbrella. We have a long way to go, but a lot of progress has been made towards the commitments to help every country practice these global health security agenda activities that will help bring them into compliance with the international health regulations.
And stop epidemics like Ebola in their tracks. As we saw today in the session, of course, the countries that the U.S. and others are working with are not only in Africa, but really span across the globe. Are there any final words or any best place people can go for more information or resources about global health security?
Sure. There's a U.S. government website, and the CDC website has great depth information. There are also articles in the medical literature that also go in deep into the action packages or 11 targets that clearly define for the public health community the importance of the activities under the global health security agenda. And I liked how you asked me your last question, which is that outbreaks are truly inevitable, but epidemics are preventable. And we need to be able to work around the globe in partnership, as every country everywhere needs to be prepared, because emerging infections and possibly even intentional release of dangerous organisms are a reality in today's world, and every country needs to be prepared to stop outbreaks where they occur, and we're all in this together.
Thank you very much, Jordan. Please join us next time for CDC Beyond the Data.